Hi guys, welcome to the channel. My name's Chris Wright. I'm in Shropshire still. And today what I want to talk about is Ansel Adams' zone system. Now this follows on from a few comments that were made on last week's video that I thought it was worth expanding on. And so what are we going to do? We're going to talk about Ansel Adams and the zone system and how that evolved from a system that was designed to deliver perfect exposures, perfect negatives to the perfectly exposed negatives to the darkroom. And what is meant by this is really an absence of completely crushed blacks and an absence of completely blown out highlights. And the thinking behind this was twofold. One is that you would be then able to produce a negative that would be successfully printed. In other words, there would be ink on every part of the frame and not too much ink on the blacks. But also it was had a much more practical element, which was the art of visualizing a black and white photograph whilst looking at a color scene. And not everybody is very good at this. I'm not very good at this myself. Because what it requires is the ability to translate colour into black and white, and that's not the most straightforward thing to be able to do. Now, the way that this works in digital photography is somewhat different, and I'm drawing a parallel here, because in Ansel Adams' world, what he was getting at was what he called visualization. And so he was effectively determining what the print would look like whilst he was on location taking the photograph. And that process of using a formal system to identify the range of tones in a scene carried all the way through to the printing process for Ansel Adams. What I think is the case nowadays is that we have a slightly different use, because our cameras are equipped with sensors and with the ability to measure the amount of light, metering, and we always calculate that based on the value of middle grey, and that will do a pretty good job. However, it is still, as we know all too well, it's still possible to blow out your highlights, it's still possible to crush your blacks in the raw file. And the consequence of doing that is that you have less choice in the edit. Now, when it comes to the edit, one of my favourite comments from last week was somebody alluded to editing in some cases being a case of that turned out well, didn't it, as a consequence of fairly randomly adjusting sliders in no particular order or with no intention. And what I've often advocated in my videos is approaching the task of editing with intent. In other words, visualizing what you want the picture to look like. Do you want it to be high contrast, low contrast? And what steps from that step, working out what steps you need to take in order to deliver that as a print or as a photo for social media. And if you adopt this approach, you'll find that your skills will get more finely honed, and more essential than that is you'll find you get what I refer to as a repeatable process. I could make the same print twice out of the same image, and I don't rely on accident to get me there. Now, all of this being said, it's also important to add that accident can be a vital component of creativity, and that it's not necessary to adhere every step of the way to some, you know, formally laid out doctrine. It's not about that at all, but it's more analogous to the fact that the best craftsmen, the best sports people, the best people generally have mastered a craft element And you see this in the tennis of Carlos Alcaraz, for example, where there is absolutely evident there is an element of complete joy about the production of a fine point. And yet there are countless hours of tedious practice that goes into creating that tennis player who has managed to elevate the craft of tennis into an art. And I think it's essential to be a master craftsman in order to become a successful artist with a successful vision that is interpreted by others. Okay, so from this point, let's get into the software. We're going to look at how DxO have made it possible to work directly with Ansel Adams' Zone system in Nick Collection's Silver Effects. So let's get into the software. Okay, here we are in Adobe Lightroom. Now we've got a very innocuous picture of a church. This is an Anglo-Saxon church in the village of Harley in Shropshire. Looks reasonably well exposed. I can see from the histogram I've got no crushed blacks, although this area looks like a candidate, as does this, and possibly the shadows and the iron gate here. I might want to retrieve a little bit more detail from this area, and I might want more structure on this area, but I can do all of that in Silver Effects. So my purpose here is simply to ensure that there's no blown highlights and no crushed blacks. Now, this picture I can now take through to Silver Effects. So right click on the picture and we'll go to Nick 8 Silver Effects. And here we are. Now, the first thing to point out is we've got this zone system here. And if you can see as I move across this, that the individual zones are being highlighted. And what this tells me is I've got a good distribution of zones for printing. This is going to work. So I can, with it, as long as I stay within this parameters, within the black and within the white level, I'm going to be good for printing. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn on zone 0 and zone 10 because I want to know if I overstep the mark inadvertently here. And let's do this two ways. We can go for a preset and choose my classic preset. The preset that I use probably more often than any other is the high structure preset. I think that just adds a little bit of drama to proceedings. And what immediately happens is we can see these hatchings arrive in the clouds here. Now what that's being triggered by is my zone system. If I turn that off, the hatchings disappear. So this is a warning that if I take this to print, and it looks okay, but if I take it through to print, there's going to be no ink laid down. That will look effectively like a hole in the print. That's not good. So we're going to need to correct for that. And we can either do this with the brightness, but notice that as we do that, we're invoking the hatchings here. So we're getting areas of crushed blacks. So the brightness isn't going to work. So we take down the highlights, and we can take those practically all the way down. And that hasn't worked particularly well either. And we've got our setting amplify whites here. If I take that away, and then if I come back here and take a little bit of highlights away, I'm getting more or less the same picture, but I'm getting one that will print, and that's the important thing. Okay, now I'm going to take my mid-tones. This is just personal taste. Now I'm going to take my mid-tones down a bit just to get a little bit more division around here. So I don't think it's necessary to amplify those all that much. But that's the structural piece. That's going to push that into the black, so we'll take that away a little bit. And we can see those shadows start to lift just at the end of this scale. So let's see if we can lift the shadows without harming the picture. Okay, so I think that's reasonably good. All right, so that's now gives us a view. So we've got those are our darkest areas now, and that's zone one. They will print zone two, zone three, zone four, five, six, seven, eight, nine. Okay, so that's all good. Now, the one bit that worries me ever so slightly is the zone two is occupying about 30% of the picture, and that makes it a little bit dark. You could say that that's dramatic, but you know, it's subjective from this point in. Now, what I might do is put a luminosity mask in here. I'm going to pick that level there, and that puts me squarely in zone two. And what I want to do lift the brightness a tiny little bit. And you can see this is really a very small adjustment, 11% there, but it just gives a little bit more detail to this roof. Okay, and let's apply that, or let's actually come away from that. So that's looking much better, I think. Now we can press on here, but my point is more that we've still got preponderance in zone two, or we've got a majority of tones in zone two, but we've mitigated it to an extent because we can see detail in this roof, and that's fine. That's what I was after. So this is looking like a well-exposed, quite contrasty photograph, and I'm going to apply that. So here it is in Lightroom. Let's look at this as full screen. Okay, and I think that's a fairly decent representation. So this gives us a view of how we can constructively use the zone system within SilverFX Pro. Okay, so that's it for the studio demonstration. So I think we've seen how it's possible to work with the zone system, and if you adopt the view that the zone system is not some rigid doctrinaire policy that dictates how you output your negatives, it is instead a tool that allows you to see what the distribution of tones is in your picture, in your raw file, And if we use it in that way, we can then make creative decisions. Do we want this to be high contrast? Do we want to crush the blacks? Even do we want to blow the highlights? Personally, no, never. But in some cases, that's definitely an option. If you're shooting into the sun, that's no longer an option. That is part and parcel of the picture. But the using the zone system gives us a view of the tones across the photograph without actually having to work it out for ourselves. And I think that's a very useful piece. Now, the implementation in Silver Effects is a lot more comprehensive than the one in Photolab, and it is to be hoped that perhaps DxO will enhance it a little more in Photolab, but certainly it's possible to work very effectively with this system in Silver Effects. Thanks for watching, guys. As ever, I hope this has been useful. If you've got any comments or questions, even stick them down below, and don't forget to give us a like, or if you're not subscribed, subscribe to the channel. That would be absolutely fantastic. All right, thanks a lot, guys, and we'll see you next week. Thanks.